Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Holy Father, you reward the righteous and the just for their true faith and their profession of that faith. You clothe their bodies with glory and their souls with light. Make us worthy of your abundant mercy and grace, that we may find you as they found you, and enter with them into the dwellings of light, where we will raise glory and thanks to you, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, forever.
Oh,
Then the king will say to those on his right,
Come, you who are blessed by my Father. Inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. A stranger, and you welcomed me. Naked, and you clothed me. Ill, and you cared for me. In prison, and you visited me. Then the righteous will answer him and say, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you as a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? When did we see you ill or in prison and visit you? And the king will say to them in reply, Amen, I say to you, whatever you did for one of these least brothers of mine, you did for me. Then he shall say to those on his left, Depart from me, you accursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink, a stranger, and you gave me no welcome. Naked, and you gave me no clothing. Ill, and in prison, and you did not care for me. Then they will answer and say, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty, or a stranger, or naked, or ill, or in prison, and not minister to your needs? And he will answer them, Amen, I say to you, what you did not do for one of these least ones, you did not do for me. And these shall go off to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life. This is the truth. Peace be with you.
Praise and blessings to Jesus Christ, our Lord and God.
Back and forth. It's the reason why Rome was moved to Constantinople, to put it further east so that the imperial government and the emperor could watch over these battles between Persia and Rome, and Persia and Rome. And what happened is when Nisibis was lost on one of these many battles, as part of the treaty, the Christian population of Nisibis was allowed to leave under protection. Because, of course, Persia was still primarily, it was pagan, it was a pagan government, pagan nation, though there were Christians in it. The Christians were always considered suspect because further west was Christian. And so, in the midst of all of this turmoil, Ephraim is allowed to leave and he moves further west to Edessa. Now, I mentioned Ineffable because St. Ephraim is famous, of course, for his poetry. Now, Ephraim was a deacon, and he lives in the 4th century. He's a slightly younger contemporary to St. Ambrose. But he lives in that complete explosion of intellectual and religious thought in the 300s. St. Gregory of Nyssa, St. Gregory Nazianzen, St. Basil, St. Ephraim. All of these men, St. Ambrose, St. Augustine, an extraordinary explosion of thought that takes place in that century, which is still fundamental to us today. And we don't even come to the question of ranking of these great fathers of the church. Now, Ephraim is very much aware of how the Greeks are writing about God and religious truth. But Ephraim is part of the Semitic tradition. And so in the Semitic tradition, the idea is that God always remains ineffable. You cannot speak of or talk of the divine. Our word infant, or a Latin term, infans, literally means something which doesn't talk, from effere. And so ineffable means you are unable to talk and to speak about, in this case, the divinity. So the vision of St. Ephraim, and as I mentioned, his importance is he's further east of what is our tradition in our family, which is the Western Syriac tradition, the western part of Syria, towards the Mediterranean, not the eastern part of Mesopotamia. But St. Ephraim's vision in his poetry, his theological writings of poetry, are so important that that influence exercises itself, which is why the Maronites stand out distinct, and that they are a Western Syriac tradition, but which is also heavily influenced by the Eastern Syriac, and with St. Ephraim. And what St. Ephraim is doing in his poetry of speaking about something which is unspeakable, in the same vision as the prophets of the Old Testament, you have what is cannot be described. And so in the poetry, you say something about it, but of course, it's not ultimately true. So you wind up on the other side of this ineffability, saying something contrary to it. And you do this poetic dance around the indescribable divinity in the center. It's why we have, as I've talked to you in these last few weeks, but it's especially struck me this year, is the poem of the hymns of the Kolo from the Genealogy Sunday, of describing Mary and Joseph as being wheels of fire. You can only do this in poetry. No one's going to write a rhetorical, logical, philosophical essay and talk about people as being wheels of fire. You can only do this in poetic form. And so St. Ephraim, he dies in the year 373. So he dies about 20 years after the conversion of St. Augustine and about 20 years before the death of St. Ambrose, to get kind of your parameters and perspective historically. So St. Ephraim is great in showing us this poetic vision. But when we return to the vision for us to finish with today in the Gospel, what is holiness? Holiness is contact and being a channel of grace because of what we see, we communicate. God is honored in the Incarnation because our Lord's entrance into this world between these wheels of fire, Mary and Joseph in Bethlehem, He brings to the human race a restoration by his incarnation. And the human race, the human nature which had been wounded and affected by the offense of original sin in the garden, is restored in the humanity and in the person of our Lord. In that restoration is the question of how we then, as individual persons outside of our Lord, come to participate in that restoration. It's the reason for the divine mysteries. It's the reason why week after week we are part of the divine mysteries, so that therapeutically, it's the Eastern vision of salvation, therapeutically we are restored and healed as grace works in us week after week, day after day, month after month, year after year. And to remove ourselves from the divine medicine, which is not grace, the divine medicine is our Lord, only condemns us to perish. Now we're told nothing about what prepares the sheep and the goats. But what we are told is that the goats are blind, and that they do not see the Christ. Not meaning the Lord who sits in majesty above them at the moment of the last day, but they do not see the Lord on a daily basis. And that is the source of their damnation. To have an idea about religion and to have an idea about Christianity is a good start. But it's only a start. It is not sufficient. As we mentioned, the goats refer to our Lord as being Lord. It is that constant introduction by grace into the ineffable that gives us the vision to see, and in seeing we act. I want to give one example. When I came back, and I mentioned to you about the retreat, when I came back, of course, we went from 10 degrees below zero to when I arrived back the following week, it was 50. So this is insane. And of course, it was pouring down rain that Friday. When I had parked my car, very mundane, and had taken the shuttle to the airport, the gentleman who drove the shuttle bus was probably Eritrean or something, clearly speaking in Arabic form, a Semitic language. And the fine features I'm considering, I thought, a younger man. When I came back, there was an older gentleman, middle-aged, with clearly a heavy Arab accent. Now I know they're trying very hard to make Maine be less white than it has been up until now, and so the federal government is moving more and more immigrants in. Okay, that's a whole different political issue. But the one-on-one contact is how Christianity is communicated. Not on saving the world, but saving my neighbor, my colleague, my fellow student, my family. And so I'm looking out the rain after a disastrous day of traveling up the East Coast with all the storms and cancellations of flights, watching this downpour and this poor man driving the car in silence at 10 o'clock at night because the flights are all late. And the human reality of the whole thing struck me as being ultimately profoundly pathetic. And so, of course, who talks in the shuttle bus, right? So no one's talking, we just get out. And it's just he and I in this bus anyway. And I'm exhausted. It's a good thing we went on retreat. It's nice to store up all that extra restful prayerfulness and then like obliterate it in the period of 10 hours, 12 hours, 14 hours. But the reality of the vision never changes. And I know with all the heated polemics of going around in the media that this man is living through this reality of everyone screaming at each other across the United States. And so I got out of the shuttle bus, and as the rain is pouring down on top of us, and he's loading my suitcase into the back of the car, I looked at him and I said, Ahlan wa salam, which generically means in Arabic, welcome. But it literally means Ahlan, it means family. Wa salam refers to the bread. So you're literally saying family and bread, meaning you are part of who we are as family and we share what we have with you. It's a very beautiful greeting. And the Christians in the Middle East will use it instead of using Salam Alaikum, peace be upon you, because it's too identified. It's a beautiful greeting, but it's become identified with Islam. But even better, the Christians in the Middle East say Mahaba, which is a corruption of the Arab, is an Arabic corruption of the Syriac Morhabu. The Lord is love. And so the Christians in the Middle East will say Mahaba in Arabic. From an old term reminding us as we greet the other person, Morhabu, that the Lord is love. And when I said this to this man, Ahlan wa salam, knowing he recognized it, his face in the middle of this rain at 11 o'clock at night immediately lit up. He started speaking Arabic. Of course, it's pouring down rain and we're both exhausted. So we exchanged a few things in English, thanked him, gave him his pittance as a tip, and I drove away in the rain to come back here very blessedly to nice winter weather, the way it's supposed to be, and away from the humidity of Florida. It's a little story. It is, in a longer term of things, absolutely insignificant. But it's how we have to begin to think and how we act in correspondence with those around us, which is why our Lord gives this list. I was hungry, you fed me, you gave me drink, you covered me, I was naked, you visited me because I was in prison, or I was sick. Very few prisoners are there because they're wonderful, worthy people. And our Lord adds it to the list to shatter that image, that we help those that we judge as being worthy. We don't do it because of the person. We do it because of what God has done for us. And because of the goodness and love that I have received, I know that there is a weight. St. Augustine has a beautiful phrase, Amor meus fondus meus. My love is my burden. And that love has been given to us in the gospel of redemption. That weight and that burden requires that on occasion we have to say to someone, perhaps who's Muslim, Ahlan wa salam. And after I had said it to them in Arabic, I said, welcome to America. Well, what are you going to do? It's not going to resolve anything. But on a personal level, this made a huge difference. For him, at least in those 10 minutes. Well, we are looking at the question of sanctity that we celebrate this week of All Saints, is that holiness is something that God gives to us in His Son, engrafting us therapeutically by the divine mysteries that we individually are obliged then to share, not with the world, but with the person with whom we work, the person with whom we live, the person with whom we may go to school. And that is why our Lord has this big list in the gospel of what we now call the corporal works of mercy. But what our Lord is judging is not the stuff that we do, but He's judging why and how we do it. If you remember, we'll close with that. Look at the sheep. They act just as confused as the goats. When were you naked and we covered you, Lord? When were you sick and we visited you? And our Lord says that when you did this for the least of my brothers, you did it for me. They both answer in kind of a confused manner. But the difference between the sheep and the goats is that the sheep have allowed themselves to be transformed by grace within the reality of incarnate love, which is the honor of God incarnate in our divine Lord, our God and Savior, Jesus Christ. So may St. Ephrem intercede for us and allow us the vision to enter into the ineffable, and even more difficultly, allow grace and the divinity of our Lord to transform us into ourselves being vehicles of incarnate, ineffable grace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
One God, Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth. Christ our God.
Lord, you dwell on high and look down upon the earth. Through the grace of your only Son, send your blessings upon those who bow before your holy altar. We glorify and honor you, your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
O God, the Father, in your love for all people, you sent your Son into the world to bring the lost sheep back to you. Do not turn your face away from us as we celebrate this spiritual and bloodless sacrifice, relying upon your mercy and through the grace of your only Son. We ask that this mystery instituted for our salvation not be for our salvation condemnation. Rather, may it blot out all our sins and forgive our faults and be an expression of our thanks for your goodness. We glorify and honor you, your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Father, Especially our blessed fathers,
Francis, the Pope of Rome, Bishara Peter, our Patriarch of Antioch, Nisrala Peter, our retired Patriarch, Gregory John, our Bishop, and all the orders of the Church and those who serve you. We pray to you,
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, our parents and all our brothers and sisters, those who are praying here with us, and those who are not here, and those who have asked us to remember them in our prayers. Answer the petitions that will lead to their salvation. Remember those who have presented offerings upon your holy altar, for those who have been offered, and for those who desire to make an offering but were unable, those whom we have remembered and those whom we have not. Reward them with the joy of your salvation and accept their offering upon your heavenly altar. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, our civil leaders and clothe them in your fear, that they may stand for justice and establish peace. Remember also captives and prisoners, the sick, the suffering, and the afflicted, the needy, and those who labor in all walks of life. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, all those who pleased you from the beginning, the holy and glorious ever-Virgin Mary, the patriarchs, prophets, apostles, St. John the Forerunner, St. Stephen, the Archdeacon and First Martyr, St. James, the Brother of the Lord, St. Joseph, St. Jude, St. Maron, St. Sharbo, and all the saints. In your grace, count us among them in the Church of the Firstborn who are enrolled in heaven. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the fathers and teachers who spread the word of truth in your holy church and preached your holy Son, Jesus Christ, to all nations. Through their prayers, grant peace to your church and confirm their teachings in our souls. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O God, of all spiritual and earthly beings, the faithful departed who have died in the true faith. Grant them rest and do not take their fault into account. Through our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ, who is without sin, we hope to find mercy and forgiveness for our sins and for theirs.
Grant rest, O God, to the departed, and forgive the sins we have committed, with or without full knowledge.
Grant us pardon, O God, and forgive us and the departed, so that your blessed name may be glorified in us and in all things. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Your love, your God, your Lord, 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 your
God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Father of mercies and God of all consolation, you have sanctified the offerings and the gifts presented to you, and have perfected them by the grace of your only Son and the descent of your Holy Spirit. Sanctify us so that with pure hearts and enlightened souls, we may call upon you, Holy Father, God of heaven, pray, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory of yours, now and forever.
Yes, O Lord our God, lead us not into temptation, that we do not have the strength to endure. But when we are tempted, deliver us through Jesus Christ our Lord. And we glorify and honor you, your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your head before the God of mercy, before his forgiving altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, who gives life to those who partake of him, and receive the blessing from the Lord.
O Lord, we bow our heads before you, awaiting your abundant mercy. Send your blessings upon us and sanctify us, so that we may become worthy to share in your holy mysteries, through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and his mercy and love for all people. You are blessed and glorified with him and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the most holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility, and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father,
one Holy Son,
one Holy Spirit.
Blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth. To him be glory.
Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy blood, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins, and for my life, O Lord our God, to you be the glory forever.
Thank you.
indescribable love for all people. Since you have made us worthy to share your heavenly banquet in your Holy Spirit, do not forsake us for having received your holy mysteries, but keep us in the radiance of holiness and of righteousness. With the saints, may we obtain a share in the heavenly reward for the grace of your only Son and his love for all people. We glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, who is good, life-giving, and consubstantial with you, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
Amen.
Jesus, our Lord, protect us, bless us, protect us, and guide us on the path of life. Favorably remember the departed of those who have shared in this Eucharist that was offered upon this divine altar. Grant protection to the living and bless them with hope. Through the prayers of the Virgin Mary and of all the saints, now and forever. So remember this week's bulletin we have written up so you have something of the history of the number of popes who were born in Syria. Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory.